Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for tuning in to Late Night Leos with MS2 Enterprises. Tonight's episode is brought to you by our generous sponsors, Luxurious Leopards, Lilith's Leo Lovables, SC Geckos, the Reptile Report Marketplace, Holly's Homebred Reptiles, Happy Gecko Sticky Situation, and Top Notch Leopard Geckos. So tonight for my co-host, I have got Jeff Scott. Jeff, you want to say hello to everybody?
Hello, everybody. I think my bird did, too.
and tonight we've got Marcy from MS2 Enterprises, who is here on the line with us. Marcy, you want to say hello?
Hey, good evening, everybody.
Hi, Marcy.
Hey.
That worked just perfect that I picked you up when I was introducing you.
Oh, really? I'm
that worked out really well.
I thought that was my bird screeching.
why don't you jump into the history of how you got started with reptiles and all that fun stuff?
I got started with reptiles many years ago. Oops, let me mute my computer. It just suddenly started making noise. Okay. I started getting involved with reptiles years ago. I got a bearded dragon from Petco years ago, and it had yellow fungus. And I was just devastated because I was, you know, it was my first little baby, and I was so sad. And I waited years and years after that. I was like, I love them, but I just never wanted another one. Well, my husband and I went to the pet store, and at the time, was breeding African cichlids, and I have, like, four large fish tanks in the living room, and with my arthritic condition, I have, like, an autoimmune arthritic condition, I was thinking of getting out of breeding them just because the water changes were just impossible. So my husband was having to do water changes on four, like, really big tanks. And so we go to the pet store, and I always had, like, tons of credit because I brought them, like, gorgeous African cichlids all the time. And so the pet store guys know me really well, and they give me these two little, or they offer me these two little bearded dragons that they're wherever they get their pets from, they were injured. And so one was Gimpy and was Stumpy. I had already named them before I even took them home. And my husband's like, no, you can't have them. We have all these fish tanks. We don't need anything else. And I'm like, sitting there going, oh, but look at them. The little one's got a little bloody stump, and the other one on her arm, and the other one's got a little, you know, foot all messed up. I'm like, I could nurse them back to health. And, you know, I, because of my arthritic condition, I wasn't working, so I was bored. And I'm like, you know, I would have fun with them and blah, blah, blah. So we had to go run some errands. And, of course, by the time we finished errands, he was driving me back to the pet store to pick up Gimpy and Stumpy and all the supplies that we needed for them. And so, and that's what got me started. Well, I hated crickets. I was freaked out by crickets. And the crickets here in Alaska are expensive. I'm trying to remember what the last price I paid. Here in Wasilla, I just paid for 24 crickets. It was $3.26.
Okay.
So when I just moved up here, just to get my guys by until I ordered 5,000 for my cricket eaters, I paid $3.26 for 24 crickets, and it didn't even look like 24. So it was just insane. So I decided to kept hearing about Dubia, and I'm like, I really think I should do this. My husband's like, I don't like that. idea. I don't like that idea. And I'm like, well,
usually it's the other way around.
Yeah. And I'm like, well, you know, it'll save us money. Because by that point I was buying mouse crickets, by the 3,000 to 5,000 crickets. And he hated the crickets escaping and all that stuff. And I'm like, well, these dubia things, you know, we don't have to worry about them escaping. They don't jump and they don't fly and they don't do this. And, you know, basically we'll just, you know, they'll just reproduce and I'll have free food and I won't have to keep buying. And he's like, that one I'm over, you know. So
yeah.
I started purchasing dubia. And so I bought all these dubia. I don't know how much I spent, probably more than I told him that I spent on dubia. So I had this really, really big colony going. And, you know, the people that, you know, I bought dubia from would send, like, little bags of chow. And one of them, I thought, may have given my colony mites. And I was, like, really freaked out. I don't know for sure if it really did or I don't know. I saw, the little fecal kit, the little tiny microscope, and I saw one little bug, and that freaked me out. I was like, oh, my gosh, I just spent, like, X amount of dollars that I can't tell my husband exactly how much I spent on them. You know, like, he couldn't believe a dollar, a female, for a cockroach.
I get that all the time.
And so I'm, like, panicking, thinking, oh, my gosh, I don't want this to destroy my colony. And so I convinced my husband to help me wash my entire colony of dubia in the upstairs bathroom. So I got a totally clean tub. I had another tub. And we washed every single dubia and dried every single dubia, including the babies. So it was just like this. I almost wish we filmed it because it was hysterical. And, I mean, it's just one of those things that I laugh almost hysterically to this day over the whole scene, you know. And at this point, I'm like, I'm petrified of them. You know, I hadn't gotten used to them yet. And so I'm like freaking out over washing these dubia. But I'm also like petrified of losing, you know, the hundreds of dollars that I spent on this very large colony. And so at that point I decided, well, you know, I'm pretty sure it was the food that I put in there that made this whole issue. And so I started doing research on what is, you know, what would be good for food. And I spent hours researching, and I talked to people about what they use, and I, you know, read forums, and I just spent hours and hours and hours of research. And, you know, meanwhile, I'm, you know, rehabbing these little, you know, stumpy and gimpy bearded dragons. And so I come up with this recipe, and it was like almost an instant success. I made, I think, one or two tweaks to the recipe, but I put it in there, and I had purchased several towels from other people, and, you know, I'd look in there, and I'd be like, oh, they might have eaten some, I don't know, you know, and then I put my towel in there that I had, this recipe that I came up with, and I was like, holy cow, look at that, it's a steamed bean, you know, and I was, like, so excited. And so then I sent some out to some of my friends that I talked to on the computer, and I was like, check this out, you know. And they were like, holy cow, I've never seen anything like that. And so that started the whole idea of, like, what would it take to actually do this? And my husband was, you know, he was excited over it because, you know, we talked about it as, you know, being a possible, you know, small business venture. And for me, it's always just been a, you know, I want to make really good food. And we literally don't make bank on it. I mean, essentially, we either break even or, you know, our first year, we, you know, we took a loss because we had to buy, you know, a bunch of equipment and, you know, things.
Yeah.
But you know, basically, it's kind of a break-even thing, and I don't even care because it's I never set out to be a, you know, a millionaire making chow. I set out to make really good food that I was confident in, that I could feed to my any of my insects, you know, crickets, mealworms, supers, dubia, and I wouldn't worry about any of my reptiles at all. And
I remember you sent me a little sample packet of it, and I go, all right, yeah, whatever, it's green, I'll put it in there. And then I was doing some other stuff in the gecko room, and I could hear them. It was kind of creeping me out. I was wondering, I don't hear very good anyway, but I was wondering where the sound was coming from, and I looked in my roach bin, and they're all, like, fighting over the food dish. I'm like, dang. Yeah, they went nuts on that.
The first time when I had the recipe nailed, I took a video because it was literally, I mean, it was a stampede. You could hear them running. And I was like, wow, this is amazing. So it still amazes me to this day. I'm like, this is awesome.
So it's a top secret.
And Morgan, you got a chance to try it.
Yes, yeah, I am trying it right now. I mean, I like to try everything, you know, and the shipping from Alaska was a big deal. So, I mean, I was really happy that you came to the Reading Reptile Show because I've been wanting to try it.
Yeah, I was really happy to be able to go to that show. And
that was fun.
Mark and I would like to be able to go to maybe several shows next year, including the Reading Show. So, you know, I think that, you know, we'd like to be able to go to maybe like the San Diego Super Show. We'd love to go to Tinley and then, you know, the Reading Show. So, I mean, it's just a matter of what his work schedule is like. And like I said, for me, it's never been about making a huge dollar. And it's never that, you know. It's just that I'm making a great product. You know, I've met some amazing people. I'm confident about what we do. And it's just truly been a blast. And I've learned so much about nutrition, not just with, you know, the chow, but I spent a lot of time learning nutrition about feeders. So, you know, I don't know if you guys have done a feeder episode, but I'd love to be involved in like an episode talking about feeders.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
And you going to do some more silkworms for me, Marcy?
I would love to do more silkworm. I need to, I would like to get another batch set up before my breeding season starts.
Yeah.
And I love doing silkworms. And a lot of people hate it, but I love doing them. It's a lot of work. It's more work than most people even care. It's like caring for babies. And,
you
like,
get up
you
a
know,
bunch of times a bajillion.
It is so much work. If there's any condensation, if there's, you know, it's like if there's a germ, they're dead. If there's any condensation, they're dead. I mean, but I enjoy it. It's kind of fun. It's been, I have a special going right now for MST Chow. I've got six that I will be happy to send out. Normally it's 20.03. But I will send it out for $17.03, so that's $3 discounted off shipping. So if anybody's interested, they can PM me. Available just till Monday. Next week, I'll be at the hospital, and so I'm going to note that on my website.
Okay, and that's good. So Monday the 25th.
We'll have to wait until
Monday the 25th.
Yeah, Monday the 25th. That will be good through Monday the 25th.
Okay, just in case somebody listens to this in October and they're like, oh.
Monday, August 25th.
2014.
Yeah, and they need to get it in by like 3 o'clock Alaska Standard Time. So I have time to get it to the post office.
So you just moved, right? How do you like your new place?
I really love my new place. Well, I don't know about love. I love the fact that I have a room completely dedicated to the reptiles.
That's all you need.
I'm good with that. I've got a kitchen, which makes me happy, and a reptile room. And everything else is kind of, well, you know, it's all deal. However, I found out that our landlord sold, or is in the process of selling this house, and it's a duplex, and plans on occupying one half of the duplex. And so there's a sale pending. So one of the tenants, either us or the other half, has to go. So I'm actually not, I'm not unpacking any boxes any more than I already have.
Yeah.
And we moved rather quickly just because of the timing with my husband's job, and our lease in Juneau ended. And so we wanted to just take advantage. Instead of re-signing a lease, we just said, okay, let's just go. And, you know, this happened to work out. But we're actually going to buy a place, and I've actually found a couple places that have even larger reptile rooms for me.
Well,
and so
go.
I'm going to be in the process in the next couple of weeks of actually looking for another home and moving again. But this will be a, like, a, you know, a purchased home. So
you won't have to move
waiting
again.
A year. We had planned on waiting a year and just staying here for a year and saving up more of a down payment. But with the owner selling everything, it just kind of made us go, you know what, let's just go.
Yeah. That's when we finally bought this place here. We rented a place, and then, oh, the owner's selling it. It's like, oh, okay. We rented another place. Oh, they want to sell it. Do you want to buy it? No. And then we bought this place. I don't know. The timing was pretty good when it happened. Well, the timing's never good when you got to move like that, but it's no fun moving, huh?
No, I've been pretty exhausted, and I haven't really talked much to anybody or haven't done much of anything other than look at boxes. And I think the first room to get done was the gecko room.
Of course.
In fact, my girlfriend might be here. Will you check them? I have my girlfriend who's coming over to help me Tetris boxes so I can walk through.
Oh, yeah.
The house. I'm sorry about my dog.
I'm
too crazy.
Chasing the bears off.
I have a Pekingese pit bull.
Hmm.
I have a Pekingese pit bull, and she's like, that's the legs of a Pekingese, so they're about like 4 inches long.
Same.
She's got the body of a pit bull.
Yeah, you showed pictures of her. I think I've seen her before. Yeah, my chicken bird quit squawking. I put the cover on the cage. She was going nuts.
But anyways, I won't be able to stay on for very long tonight. And I think that if you have any questions about Shell, I normally would have been able to stay on longer, but she just
we
showed up, and I know you guys know about my neck. I had neck surgery. I've got a ruptured lower disc, and I have a rib that dislocates. And so she's here to help me Tetris a bunch of boxes so I can at least walk through my house without tripping and killing myself. And so I can talk for a little bit longer, but I really desperately need the help. And my husband went back to the North Slope. And so it's just been my son and I, and it's just like, oh, my Lord.
So if any of you guys have any questions in the chat room, you need to ask them now because Marcy's going to be gone pretty soon. But I did have a question. Now, when I opened up the Roach Chow, what is, like, the main smell in there? Because I smelled something that was, like, you know, I wouldn't be against, like, licking my finger and sticking it in the Roach Chow and eating it.
I can't tell you, but it's good stuff.
Okay, because I might have...
It smells good, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. That really bothered me because I was like, you know when you smell something and you don't know what it is exactly?
Yeah, you want to taste it.
Hold on. Yvonne, will you grab her so she stops barking at you? Okay. You guys would be like, I think any man that was watching. If this is like a webcast, you guys would be like, oh my gosh, you have a beautiful Amazon woman here. My one of my good friends, Yvonne, is like 6 feet tall and beautiful.
Oh, pictures or it didn't happen.
I will take a picture of my beautiful Amazon woman. She's wonderful. She and I've been friends for like 20 plus years, and she's fabulous.
Cool.
We do have a question.
Are you on the radio show?
I'm on the radio show.
Elsa is wondering if the chow can be used for hornworms and silkworms.
No, I wouldn't use it for hornworms or silkworms. Hornworms require a specific chow. A lot of companies make a hornworm chow. And there are some recipes for hornworm chow, but it's very difficult to make, and it's very difficult to make where it doesn't mold. Dishwasher. Silkworm chow, silkworms will typically only eat mulberry leaves or mulberry powder paste that you make. In a pinch, you can feed silkworm grated carrots. They will turn orange. But that is that's usually only in a pinch, and they may or may not eat it. For people that are in a pinch and they're completely out of like mulberry leaves or, the mulberry, the paste or whatever it is, you can use grated carrots. So, but they will turn orange. They'll turn a very, very cool shade of orange.
Nice.
That'd be cool.
And Tammy is asking if Rainbow is still selling the Roach Chow.
I see it's listed on there. I don't know if they have any in stock. I haven't talked to Jillian. I don't know if she still has any in stock.
Okay.
I know it's listed last week or something. I ordered mealworms, and I see it showing.
Yeah. So she may still have some in stock. I essentially have had to kind of make the decision of whether I was going to either continue making it at all and not doing much wholesale just selling it myself. And so it was a really hard choice. And so you know, it's something that we're still kind of working out. With moving to our new location, I may have access to less expensive ingredients. And, you know, everything has to be either barged in or air freighted in.
Yeah.
And so, for example, like a gallon of milk is almost $6. And so, I mean, not that I use milk and chow, but that just gives you an example. And, you know, a large package of hamburger is $24.
Jeez.
So it's everything, the price of everything in Juneau where I lived was astronomical. And so I'm hoping that being where I'm at now will give us an opportunity to reduce our prices a bit and make it more feasible to do more of the wholesale.
Yeah, because you get everything shipped to you. And I'm sure you pay some big bucks every year on shipping as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, our shipping costs are astronomical.
Sure.
Like for our bags, which I love our bags, and I'm not going to change our bags. I'm not going to get cheap, ugly bags. I will not do it. But we actually pay more for the shipping of the bags than we pay for the bags themselves.
Yeah.
But given that I'm actually on the road system now, because they can go through Canada.
Yeah.
That it is possible that FedEx can drive and the truck can drive the Alcan. And so it's possible that things can go ground now. Nothing could go ground through Juneau. Everything had to be through air. So I always had to pay second day or next day air.
That's expensive.
Yeah. So you can imagine how much the prices were. I'm actually really excited about being here because I think it will afford us the ability to do more on the wholesale level. Ideally, like I said, I'm not here to make $1 billion. If I can drop my child prices, if I can get lower prices here, then I'm going to do that. Because I like the product. I think it. I think it is. You know, a worthwhile product. My girlfriend just saw my son for the first time since he was little tiny. He's 6'4" now, so. That's so cute. He's 6'4", and the last time she saw him, he was like, I don't know how tall. That was fun.
Cool.
So I'm definitely looking forward to expanding. And we're looking at investing into getting a big mill for ourselves. So.
That'll be cool.
You can mix more up at a time.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. And most people don't know this, but we do all of our grinding by hand, 2 cups at a time.
Yikes.
Yeah. I mean, well, some of the harder items go about 2 cups at a time. And everything is hand sifted. You know, I am, you know, everything pin mixed. It's not something that I, you know, we don't.
You don't buy 50-pound bags of it and put it in little bags?
No. And, you know, I always put on, you know, most people know I don't use, you know, dog food, cat food, or chicken mash. And, you know, I use the majority of the products that I put in there are, you know, either organic or... you know, high quality human grade foods. So.
Yeah. And it's. I know my roaches. I did, like, in at the end of the season, I feed them a bunch of it because, you know, like the end of the breeding season, and everything, because my colonies need that boost, and you can tell they, you know, they start producing more.
Absolutely. Tell everybody about when I accidentally sent you some of my substrate, the worm substrate.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I don't know. What I ordered some roach chow or something, and you sent me worm substrate, and I messaged you, and then I don't know who got the roach chow, but I used it on my super worms, and it plumped them right up. I love that stuff. I just used the last of it on some super worms I have. But, yeah, it plumps them up.
I'll get you some more, Jeff.
You going to send me more?
Oh, yeah,
send
I'll
me
send
some
you
geckos.
Some more. Well, hopefully I'll have some more Afghanicus coming. I just did a pairing.
Yeah.
So hopefully I'll have some more Afghanicus. I had a late ovulator, so. That made me pretty happy.
Oh, cool.
We had a very small season this year because of moving, and I didn't do much as far as breeding is concerned. But next year I will have quite a few. I'm really excited about next year. Oh, I also have a bunch of rusty bibs, rusty ledges. I have a bunch of medium, a couple small rusty ledges, originals, hatchling, and singles for sale, and digital thermometers. And so if anybody's interested in any of those, I've moved them from Juneau to Wasilla. And I know I'm going to be moving in another month or two, and I really don't want to move them again. So I'm happy to have a sale on them. So if anybody's interested, please call me.
What kind of digital thermometers you got?
They're the Repti Ledge digital thermometers, and they have a probe. And I'll pop a picture of them up on my wall. And I'll put the sale price up. And all you need to do, because they come internationally, they don't come with a battery. And so you just need to go to the battery, like the, you know, the battery store and get a battery.
Cool.
And they're great digital thermometers. I use them, love them. I always love to have extra, like, double-check thermometers in my rack just to have an extra set of eyes.
Yeah, no, I do the same
thing. Basically, to check my temperatures. And it actually saved me. I had a thermostat go wonky. And so the probe was telling me one temperature, but my Repti-Ledge probe gave me the accurate temperature, and it was like 106.
Oh, geez.
And I was like, holy cow. So I grabbed my, you know, the infrared, and I checked it, and the Repti-Ledge one was right, and I had to, you know, get a replacement probe for my thermostat. But it really saved me to have that, and they're really not expensive. And so for me, it reinforced the fact that I want to have, you know, an extra digital thermometer on all my racks in two spots, top and bottom, so I know what my, you know, temperatures are. It just made me that much more comfortable. And because that was very scary. I was like, oh, my gosh, they could have cooked. I could have had a fire. I don't know. You know what I mean? It was just panic.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Lose everything in a flash. I'll message you on some of those. I got an idea for the Chico show.
Okay.
Fill my table up.
When's the Chico show?
September 13th. You'll be there, right?
I wish I could be there.
I know.
But maybe what I can do, if there's people that are interested in MS2 Chow, maybe I can send you a box, Jeff.
Yeah. I'm sure we can. I can, let's do something like that. Because there'll be a lot more this year at the Chico show. You know, Bruce was, my daughter's seen Bruce down there passing out flyers.
I hate people to pay the shipping.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll get with you this week or something.
Okay. How are you liking your gifts, you guys, from the Reading show?
Oh, yeah, Alaska
like
hat's cool. I'm waiting for it to get cool and I'll wear it. No, that's cool. Yeah, Morgan's probably going around slapping everybody with his
the beer cooler.
Beer cozy.
I love
thing.
That.
Yeah. My daughter loved her.
I love
her
those little stuff.
Yeah. My daughter likes hers too. Her, what was that, a scarf thingy or I don't know. It's her birthday today, so she's at her friend's.
One thing that I do want to say about using the MS2 Chow, I have had some of the most wonderful feedback about using it for cricket.
Uh-huh.
On my website, Wally Kern has left me an outstanding testimonial stating that he has been able to keep cricket alive for much longer than he has using anything else. And I've also had that same experience myself.
And you can use it with
experiences, experiences different for cricket.
Yeah.
But this has been my experience. This is what Wally has shared. I have one of the things that for people who are basically new to geckos, reptiles, keeping crickets, I encourage you to give our chow a try. And one of the things that I always do with keeping crickets is I feed a small amount of chow, just enough that they will eat it within a day, and always change their water crystals daily, and wash out their bowl. And the reason why is because they will crickets defecate in anything and everything. And so it's important to do that because they will make themselves sick, essentially. And so cleaning out any of the exoskeletons and the frass and doing those steps will keep your crickets longer, especially if you're buying in bulk, if you're a new keeper and you're finding that you have a lot of dead crickets.
Yeah, and when the crickets start dying, they let off a methane or something, and it starts killing the other crickets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't do crickets, but
I have a few fat tails that will only eat crickets. I hope to have some stellar fat tails next year. By the way, guys, I have some incredible fat tails that I purchased this year, and I'm just. I'm in heaven over them. So, mm-hmm.
Yes, I see the market's still pretty good on fat tails.
Yeah.
So I plan to have that, a bunch of Turkmenicus, a bunch of Afghanicus. So.
Oh, that's right. You got Turkmenicus, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've got quite a great colony of Turkmenicus.
Put me on your list.
Oh, heck yeah. I'm actually going to check and see if any are ovulating right now, and so I might have some late-season babies.
Cool.
And so that'll be good. I have some of the some of John's new blood Afghanicus, and one of my Afghanicus babies that I just hatched this year is just it's got the most incredible patterning. I'm not letting this one go. It's just, it has an incredible V on its back. And I'm in love with this one. I've never seen one like this. It's just so amazing. So that one's
staying with me. Apples have real nice patterns anyway. It's one of the first, that's the first thing I ever, I bred a Affy to a Blizzard was my first ever pairing.
Earthlay is now 100 grams, and he's over 10 inches, by the way.
Mac Snow Giant that I sent you?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's not even two yet, so he's not going to be bred until after he's two.
Yeah. No, they're coming out big. I have a couple of big ones from that same thing. A couple other people have them too. They're really huge. That's what I made the Super Snow Trimpers. I have from that same.
Oh, cool.
From that same group, and they're both female. Both still looking female, and they're huge. And they're, you know how like Super Snow sometimes they don't eat as good or they don't grow as fast.
Mm-hmm.
Not the case with these. So far, so good anyway.
Well, I can tell you, Urkelay is just he's a little machine, man. I can sit and feed him worm after worm, and he likes when I hand feed him, so he's kind of spoiled.
Cool.
Yeah, most of mine are pretty spoiled anyway, but definitely use the chow, MS2 chow in any of your substrate. You can use it with wheat bran. A lot of people use it with oatmeal, or give my substrate a try. One of the things Jeff told me is not only did they get plumper, but they were more active. I remember you telling me that.
Oh, yeah. They plumped up. They were more active. And, that stuff really works. I like it. I've even given the roach chow to the superworms. I put a little bit in there with wheat bran.
You can sprinkle that on there, and it's amazing how quickly it just disappears.
Yeah.
The other thing that I like to let people know is that I do not add any supplementation extra to my chow. And a lot of people ask me, why not? You should add this or add that. And the reason why I do not add anything to it is because I don't know what people are feeding. I don't know what reptiles you're feeding. I don't want to make any assumptions. And so if people have certain requirements for their reptiles, then they can add things themselves. I am going to have a full-on nutritional analysis done. We've been just broke as a joke for quite a while. And like I said, this is not a money-making operation. I'm doing it because I love it, and it's a good product. But I will have a nutritional analysis done of the product and then go from there. And then I'm also considering, I've been dabbling, I have a few things to do, like a super deluxe version of our chow that's actually higher in calcium. And so, kind of like a more of a gut load versus like an everyday food. And it's a natural, it's not like putting in calcium, it's a natural form of calcium.
So they can assimilate
food,
it better.
Which sometimes is more absorbable. I'm really excited about that. So I'm working working with that as my next product to develop. And so I'm going to try it out on a little colony. I'm going to take a little colony and see how it does. Everything that I've researched on on it, it'll be a, you know, I can see it being a good, you know, nothing but an added benefit. So I'm pretty psyched.
That's really cool.
Yeah. No, that's, you do all kinds of stuff. I mean, the supplementation and everything. I mean, you go so many different directions with your chow. And I know we've talked before about making a calcium supplement directed just for leopard geckos. And I know you're probably doing research and all that too. But that would be another good thing to do. But
you know, I would be, you know, one of the things that I would like to do is, you know, if I can get my costs down a bit here, what I'd probably like to do is get a gut load specifically for leopard geckos. So get like a chow formula specifically gut loaded with the correct, you know, a good calcium ratio.
For each species.
Have that.
For each species, like one for African fat tails, one for Leos, one for Beardies. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be. You know, I would love to do that, or to have a, you know, a small packet that you can mix into the chow.
Free prize inside.
Yeah, you know, make little packets of supplementation that people can mix into a pound of chow.
Yeah,
and that would be, you know,
that
to me would be. I would like to see something like that as well. I've always been a very big proponent of researching and being very aware of what I'm feeding my reptiles and being very careful about, you know, the things that I feed them, you know. And
I know a few years back, I don't know, it was right after Dubia started hitting real big. There was a big thing out that it was causing gout and this and that. And then they did more research, and it wasn't the Dubia itself. It was what they were feeding the Dubia causing the gout. You know, people were using dog food and high animal protein stuff. But,
and I read that was Alan Rapashi did an informal study in on the uric acid buildup in Dubia based on the animal protein being used in certain feeds, and that was causing gout in reptiles, bearded dragons. And so when I selected all of my protein sources, I selected only vegetable sources of protein. And I also weighed out the, you know, the phosphorus levels as well. And so, I mean, each particular thing had a, you know, there were every single thing that I put in, I weighed it out, and I was like, you know, what's the benefit of this?
Yeah.
And, you know, I do tell people, yes, there is bee pollen in my chow. And the reason why I tell people this is that some people are allergic to bee pollen. And either just breathing it. I've had people actually taste it. It's not something that I recommend doing because it's pet food. And legally, I could get in trouble for saying, go eat pet food, you know?
Yeah, liability reasons.
Yeah, but, you know, but people have tried it. And if they're allergic to bees, they could be allergic to bee pollen and they could have a reaction. So I always make sure that people know that there is bee pollen in the chow. Because it is an allergen. One of the reasons I also like to let people know about, like, our substrate, the oats. I use oats. A lot of people have a pretty strong reaction to wheat bran after a while. And so I use oat bran, oats, as a substrate for our worm substrate. And because after long periods of exposure, some people develop a really strong allergy to
mealworms.
The wheat bran.
Yeah, a lot of people aren't really allergic to the mealworms or the frass, but it's what they've eaten and how it changes. I think that's, I don't know, some people were going with cornmeal instead of the wheat bran when they were raising their mealworms, but
So I use oats. The one thing that I do know with the oat, it's far less of an allergen and a potential allergen. It does have a bit higher phosphorus level, and so I always recommend that whenever people are getting ready to feed off, to feed off to gut load and to dust every time. And the reason, I tell people this all the time, to gut load with, collard greens, cactus pads, spaghetti squash. Those three are some of the highest calcium loaded vegetables. There's a lot of other vegetables that don't have, that have other things that can inhibit calcium absorption. And so those three are probably the best. Other things can have oxalates or goitrogen.
Those block the calcium from them taking it.
Those can block the calcium.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Like zucchini squash, and it was high in that oxalates. But I use that, I also use Nepalese, the cactus. I love that stuff.
Those are absolutely phenomenal. And
they don't mold. They're great.
I got a case up here, and it was fabulous. The Dubia actually loved the cactus pads, too.
Yeah. You get stickers in you, but... But it's
I have
worth
a little
it.
Video on YouTube of how to do it without getting yourself too bad. I can share that with you guys later.
I'll have to. I haven't been on YouTube. I didn't know you had a bunch of videos up. I'm sure I've seen it.
I have a couple. One of the Dubia going absolutely insane over the chow. I have one of how to do a cactus pad. I have one on superworm breeding and. I don't know. I might have a couple more.
Yeah. I harvest a lot of cactus. The Nepalese grows wild here. And, I know my plant ID. But I go harvest it sometimes. But I'd rather just buy it at the store because the wild stuff, the stickers are more stickery. They'll poke you. The stuff you buy in the stores, it's been raised with more water and stuff, so it's better.
Well, sometimes at a Safeway, I can get cactus pads here, so I get very excited when I see those.
Yeah. Oh, you can get them up there?
And people don't know why, and I'm like, oh, my bugs are going to be so happy. And people look at me like, oh, I don't understand that woman.
Yeah, there's only a couple places up here I got to go to Chico to get them, but there's only a couple stores that sell them up here. In Southern California, they're all over the place because the Hispanic population down there, they make Nepalese con huevos, eggs and cactus, which is really good if you like that sort of thing. I love it, but yeah, it's good for you.
Yeah, I actually found a couple of recipes for some that, like, to eat yourself, because it is, like, really nutritious.
Yeah, it's really good. You can buy the jarred stuff, but I think it probably has too much salt in it, or it's probably not good.
Yeah, I've seen that, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure it's in brine or something.
Yeah. I was going to try and tell you guys something else. What was I going to tell you? I don't remember. I can't see the chat room, so I don't know why. I think my flash thing crashed.
Oh, your thing where you can get on the chat room?
Yeah, I'm using the old computer because I don't have anywhere to set up my good computer. So I'm using the old laptop.
Oh.
Because literally, if you saw my house, she'd kind of be chuckling, like, she's what? She's sitting in a sea of boxes? I have a table set up. My kitchen looks okay, but I have a table set up. I have a really cool burn barrel, though, and that's really been fun.
Yeah, I've seen that. That's pretty neat. They're illegal here, but I like the you like etched, I don't know, whatever in the side of that. And that was
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, my brother does that. He does burn barrels and fire pits and fire rings and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. No, they're like illegal here, but yeah, people still have them here and there, but they frown on them.
Well, did anybody have any questions for me?
Any more questions?
I think that was about it, and they were also wondering if you could make a Gargoyle and Cresty slurry type of food.
I've actually thought about it. And I'm actually tempted to do so. I have quite the collection of gargoyles and crested, and I would do it mostly just because I love my little guy so much. Don't know if you guys saw my little apple bush escaped for 2 days.
And somebody found him in the kitchen or something, yeah.
Yeah, my son found her. He went downstairs to make a quesadilla, and then he came downstairs to get something to drink, and he had dropped a piece of cheese. And she was on the floor in the kitchen eating a piece of cheese.
And that's a crusty,
which was
right?
Really funny. Normally, the dog was upstairs with me, and normally she would have chased him, you know, followed him and eaten whatever cheese was on the floor. And I'm really glad she didn't, because Applebush stopped and ate the piece of cheese.
Huh.
I don't know how good it was for her, but it made her slow down enough so that we could find her.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, but I've actually thought about doing that. And I'm really, really, really specifically interested in doing something for gargoyles. Paul Morlock, I purchased a really exquisite collection of gargoyles from Paul Morlock and from Rack House. And one of the things that he's taught me is that the gargoyles are basically at the top of the food chain, and they mostly eat other geckos.
Whoa.
And so I'm really, I'm trying to, I'm
find
trying
out which
to think
of the other
a way to, I don't know if I'm kind of not running up geckos, no, I'm not running up geckos, but I'm trying to figure out some way to create a formula that would appeal to them and their more, like, carnivorous nature. You know, because they do eat the fruits, but they, you know, they like eating little lizards, you know, and so You know, I've been kind of racking my brain, and so I'm going to do a bunch of research on that because I think that it would be a good challenge for my brain to figure something out that would be,
I think it'd be great because
kind of palatable, but it would help them, you know, grow nutritionally and all of that stuff.
Yeah,
so
not only that, I think the market's opening up for like more species, gargoyles and, you know, everything.
Absolutely, the morphs are just incredible.
Yeah.
And if anybody, I mean, I highly recommend Paul to deal with. He's just amazing.
We did have a question about that. Would the crested gecko diet, or whatever animal, the slurry that you made, like for crested geckos,
mm-hmm.
would it be considered more of a gut load if you had to feed the lizards to the gargoyles?
Aww.
I'm trying to come up with a pace because I don't think my heart can handle feeding a lizard to another lizard. So I'm trying to come up with a pace.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll make like lizard shaped paste. How about that?
There you go. Yeah, like gummies, like Flintstone gummies.
Lizard blood pudding.
I'll make lizard shaped pudding.
Yeah.
I wonder if that's what people feed those feeder house geckos and feeder anoles to, is gargoyle geckos.
Oh, that and like some snakes and stuff. I know a guy that does, he breeds king snakes, like native king snakes, and he repopulates areas around here, but he feeds them all kinds of feeder lizards and babies.
Yeah.
He blue bellies, whatever he can catch, and he breeds some geckos for him and stuff. And it's kind of sad, but king snakes got to make a living too.
Yeah.
I guess the babies are real picky until he gets them on, you know, pinkies and then the frozen thawed. And he doesn't really want to do that because he's letting a lot of them go into the wild. So, he didn't want to do the frozen thawed and, you know, just, you know, white mice or black mice or so it's one of those things. It's conservation.
Yeah, and so I really want to I'd really be interested in finding some way to achieve something for the gargoyles that doesn't involve feeding a little lizard because I'm too sensitive. I mean, I was having a conversation with Yvonne about it, and I think if I had a baby that was hatched, then I couldn't get started. My husband would go ahead and feed a little tiny lizard to it for me, and I would have to probably run out of the room, and I would be crying probably for about 2 weeks. So I definitely am like more excited about the lizard paste. Lizard-shaped paste idea.
Yeah.
Like maybe I can make like a gummy paste that you can wiggle that looks like a lizard, and then they want that. That's
like
really tricky. I got ideas now.
Gummy thing.
Well, you could make it the same shape as a little house gecko. You know.
Break out the old Mattel creepy crawler set.
Remember those? Use those molds.
Or the plastic goop in there. Yeah.
If someone's got a mold, you better holler at me and let me know.
That's weird. My sister just messaged me one of them the other day, and it's like, oh, I remember those.
I
still got scars from burning my hands on those.
Oh, yeah.
Plastic goop.
Well, I know that you got to go, Marcy, so I don't want to keep you on too long. So I do want to thank you for coming on tonight.
I'm really always very happy. I'd love to come back and just talk about bugs. And if anybody has any more questions about Chow, after we kind of get settled, my husband and I are going to make another gigantic batch of Chow. And I will also be making some more substrate pretty soon. Jeff, I'll send you a bag.
Okay.
And
I'll give it to you this week.
The Tico show, and we'll figure something out. But like I said, right now I've got a special 1703 shipped for a pound. I will combine shipping. So if someone wants to do 2 pounds, it would be, I will combine shipping. So it will be cheaper than normal. So give me a holler. I've got about 6 pounds that I can sell at that price, and I'm always happy to answer anybody's questions about chow, about feeders, and, you know, if I'm available and I can answer the question, I will.
Awesome.
Yeah, we'll have to have you on for, like, a silkworm husbandry thing, because I know a lot of people are really getting into that.
Yeah. No, I know. I got some Marcy. Oh, God. Well, a while ago, you sent me a whole bunch. And it's like, I opened the box.
Yeah, like 2 years ago, maybe? 2.5 years ago?
Yeah. And I opened the box, and it's like, holy smokes. And I didn't have as many geckos in, but they were gone pretty quick. Yeah.
I really do a good job with raising those. It kind of impresses me.
No, they were nice size too, perfect size for what I had going. I like I pair them up, you know, like when breeding season's just about to start. I like to give my female layers silkworms because they're so good for them. Number one, they're soft bodied and they digest it. You know, there's a lot of moisture in them, but I've noticed a bigger egg production when I use silkworms before breeding season begins. And if I could get them all the time, I would, God, it'd be like one of my main staples. They're just so darn expensive. Hello?
Marcy?
Did we lose her?
Yeah. I hear something. Did we lose
that?
You?
I'm here.
She's under the paper towels. Yeah.
I'm here.
Marcy, can you hear us?
Hello?
Hello, Marcy.
Okay. We're all good then.
Okay.
That was my silkworm spiel. Want me to sing the Rochelle song?
Yeah, sing it. Sing it until she comes back.
Rochelle. It's no fun unless she's listening.
Marcy, are you there?
I'm here.
Can
you
hear me?
Hello?
Can you sing the Rochelle song?
No. Can you?
You don't want me to.
You really don't want me to sing the Rogue's Child song, man. No. I kind of heard you talk about the silkworms. They're an incredible feeder. Those and phoenix worms are quite possibly some of the best feeders, I think, that are out there. And I really start all of my leopard geckos I try to give everybody a wide variety and not just one food. But silkworms and phoenix worms to me are just some of the best feeders that you can get and feed. So I would love to come back and talk about feeders, and I love helping people get different colonies started and that kind of thing. I think it's real important to, you know, a lot of us have so many geckos, at least the people that are breeding, have so many geckos that it's almost impossible to do all of the sphere feeders your own, but I think it's good to have backup.
Oh, yeah. That's my dubias and my Turks are my backup.
Yeah.
If I had more time, I would do the silkworm thing. If I had more room, I know what it involves. And we have mulberry trees here.
I actually love doing the silkworm. And, you know, I think that if I spent some more time, I wouldn't even mind just doing that just for fun because it's so meticulous and tedious. I wouldn't mind just doing silkworms for fun just because I'll use the word meticulous, but it's quite the chore.
Yeah. And we did them, I don't know, in elementary school down in Southern California. It was like every year the science teacher would bring in the silkworm eggs and we'd do the whole thing. And some years it didn't work out good because too many kids would touch them or they'd get too wet or didn't change the mulberry leaves out. And in some years it was really good. But, it's real interesting to watch them grow. They grow fast once they start growing.
Yeah, they're amazing when they hatch. They're just like a
little
tiny,
black
tiny
string thing.
Dash. Yeah, like a little tiny dash. Like if you look on your keyboard, they're like the size of the comma or an apostrophe.
That's what they look like, too. It's a little black head.
Yeah, it's like a little tiny apostrophe on a keyboard, and it's like, oh my lorsch, you know, you feel like you're gonna. I said lorsch, and gosh together. I'm really tired.
Oh my gosh.
This is what happened. Oh my lorsch. This is lorsch. That's my new word. Lorsch.
Lorsch all your dubia.
I saw somebody at the Reading show and I made them laugh so hard when I told that story. I was walking down the hall and I looked at him and we're walking past in the hallway and I'm like, give me a washcloth, and he just started laughing even more. I was like, oh my gosh, my teeth hurt so bad that night after telling that story. It was very fun.
I remember when you were doing that. Then you found out it was calcium powder or something.
Oh, I had no idea what it was. There was a little something, and who knows if it was like a little piece of exoskeleton that I saw on the little microscope. I don't know, but it was just
panic attack, roach wash.
Oh my lord. That's one for the record books. But at least you got me started on MSQ Chow, so I guess it's not all bad.
Yeah.
And it's quite comedic. It's quite comedic in hindsight.
Yeah. Didn't sound like a lot of fun then, but...
especially if you ask my husband.
I'm still having fun with it. God,
I'm still laughing.
No, I know I started dubia roaches. I got some from Ron's Reptile because he's in Chico. He gave me a bunch, and I brought them home, and the Leos went nuts on them. And then I got some more from them and started a colony, and then I got some from Doobie Deli at the Sacramento show. God, I don't know how many years ago that was. And then I buy them through the years or whatever. I'll bring in another 1,000 or, you know, I bring in fresh stock.
Yeah.
But
I need to boost my colony.
Yeah, me too.
I'm due to do that because I'm terrible at following my own advice sometimes to remember to save back like 1,000, but I always think it's good to bring in new blood too.
Yeah, it is. I know. And the more you have in there, the more they breed. It seems.
Mm-hmm.
They like crowded conditions. It seems like
very much.
because I have one that I feed out of, and then one I just let go wild and put oranges, and you know, I feed those different than the ones that I'm feeding off. But yeah, new blood, and it's and those darn red runners, Turk stand roaches, those breed so quick. I gave a bunch away a while ago, a couple times, and I still got a bunch of them.
Maybe I'll trade you some substrate for some, because I want to start a little turk colony for my own self.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll build up a colony. Give me about 2 days.
Oh, I'm really scared of them. I'm really petrified of them, but I think I'll do it just for the sake of having them.
They're more of a, you know, they're more of like, in my mind, a cockroach. Like Dubia, they're not really a cockroach. They're more like a big,
like
fat
roly poly
bug.
Yeah. Yeah, they're the roly poly bug.
The red runners are more of a, yeah, they're creepy.
Yeah, they creep me out really bad, but.
And if you don't want to put your.
Oh, his name is Gecko Bug.
Yeah. They work good for picky eaters, or I know if you get a hatchling that's kind of picky, you put some small red runners in there, and they'll. I mean, if they turn everything else down, they'll eat those.
Yeah.
Well,
I love you guys. I've got one of the most beautiful Amazon women in my kitchen right now, and she's staring at her phone, and her daughter, who's my daughter's hair twin. They have like the same kind of hair. Like if you looked at them from behind, you'd be like, you couldn't tell who they were because they've got the same exact hair.
It's a hair thing.
Yeah, it's a hair thing. I must go and handle a few boxes. I love you guys. Hope you have a wonderful evening. I want to say hello to everybody. Thank you for listening into the show. Say hi to Miss Yvonne. Say hi to Miss Elsa. Thank you very much. It was great. I got to meet Elsa. She's always listening in on the show, and I got to meet Elsa in Tacoma, so that was awesome.
Yeah, no, that's cool. No, thanks for coming on. I always like to talk to you, Marcy.
Yeah. Oh, I always love talking to you guys, too. So you have a great night.
Okay.
You too. We'll see you later.
Okay.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
No, Marcy's cool. I've known Marcy for quite a while before she even started the roach chow thing we were talking. Well, back when she just had the beardies, and I think she had a three-legged super snow rescue or something that she took in. But, kind of.
You want to make some prank phone calls?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who are we going to call?
Right.
You're going to call Josh. He's at the, where was he?
I'm calling Sasha.
Yeah, they're at the show. They're probably at a bar right now. I guess he did really good at the show.
Oh, he did?
Yeah, he sold
I hope
like.
This is his number.
Oh, just call it anyway.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Not ringing.
He probably shut it off. There we go.
One ringy dingy.
I love since I figured out how to do this.
Please leave your message for.
Hello.
She hung up on us.
She did.
Yeah.
Darn that caller ID.
I know, right?
Remember you called him at his shop or something? No,
yeah,
nice try, guys.
Oh, jeez. I cracked myself
Hello?
Up. Hello. This is Juanita's kitchen calling.
Hey, I'm going to have to call back. I got to go down to the parking lot. The reception here just sucks.
Okay.
All right. Call us back.
Call in a few minutes here. All right.
All right.
He just posted a new morph that he picked up.
Yeah?
Yeah, on
what is that? Is that like a
horn
lizard?
Like
horn lizard. Yeah.
It's plastic.
Is it a necklace or just a thing? It looks I can't
tell.
It's a thing. Huh. I can't wait to get... I want to get some horny toads, like alive ones, not plastic ones. Cause,
no,
I've
kept them before.
Yeah, and do you know who Lainey is from Florida? She used to be on Gecko Farms. Oh, I don't know if you were even on there. Were you on there?
I know I've heard that name before.
Yeah, she has the horny toads.
Huh.
But she feeds them the natural, like, the ants. So
yeah,
she has
they
to
like
get ants all the time. But Brian was saying that the zoo, they eat mealworms.
Yeah. I used to feed mealworms and crickets and then those great big red ants. You know, like Uncle Milty's ant farm?
Yeah.
Yeah, those great big red ants. I would go catch those and they bite. But they eat those. But I fed them mealworms, crickets. Well, this was way back when, and I would set up a little moth trap for them too, catch moths by porch light. Which you're not supposed to feed them wild caught insects, but this was way back when.
Yeah. Before pesticides.
Yeah. No, they've had pesticides all the time.
They had worse stuff back then.
Yeah.
Bleep that out.
Yeah, we just bleep that out. No, we used to take a great big wide mouth jar, and you put a funnel in the top, like underneath the porch light, or underneath the street lights even.
Yeah.
And they fall in the funnel and then they can't get back out. And now you can use glow sticks, but put it right in the jar to fly in. Quit beeping, would you?
Am I beeping?
I think so.
I don't know who's beeping.
I'm not beeping.
We'll just blame it on Elsa.
Oh.
Elsa's the only one that's still on the line.
Oh, okay. We'll get her on. Unless someone's trying to call.
She doesn't have a question.
Oh, she just... I know, the chat room's sleeping. What's up, people? Wake up.
I know.
Yeah. So what do you have dubious, Morgan? You doing the dubious thing?
Yes, I have giant roly-polies.
Sweet.
I don't use the C word or the R word when I describe my roly-polies because I don't own my own house, so I have to be careful what I say. I rent from my family.
Oh, yeah. You don't want an infestation. Yeah.
No, the I word's even worse. No, even though, in Eureka, I mean, it's 55 degrees, so nothing.
Yeah, they won't live very long.
But,
no,
that doesn't mean that I want them living in my gecko room, which is, 75 degrees.
Yeah.
So.
Mine took, the humidity's all off in there. It gets it's hot and dry up here, and, stuff gets loose in there sometimes, and... Or when I'm cleaning the paper towels, if I miss one that, got out of the feeder dish, and I put all the paper towels in a big container and then take them outside. But once in a while, I want to get loose. And they don't live very long.
Mm-mm.
My daughter,
I'll
pick them up, throw them out. My daughter throws them at me. I'll be sitting here on a computer and I'll feel something hit the back of my head. One of your roaches got out. Doink.
You need one of those, what I got for my room, because I'm really paranoid about just even mealworm beetles getting out. I got one of those, the two styrofoam tubes in that fabric thing that goes under your door, you know, so.
Oh, yeah.
That, you know what that's, I don't know what it's called.
It's like a pool noodle thing?
Yeah.
It's like a door seal, yeah.
Yeah.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah, you know, that's what I'll probably do that in the wintertime because that room stays warmer than any other room all year round. And I go in there in the wintertime because it's warm in there. But when I'm in there, I can feel the cold air coming under the door.
Yeah, you got to get one of those pool noodle beanbag things.
Yeah. That'd be cool. Summertime, I can use it as a floaty.
I use it as a door stop thingy all the time.
Yeah. Right.
But I notice I've got a few house spiders that are like hanging out under my my supply racks and stuff. So I think that's keeping a lot of stuff down.
Yeah, the daddy long leg things.
No, I've got like some serious humpback, like
orb spiders and.
No, what is it? Not like a recluse, but you know those ones that look like a black widow, but they're not.
Oh yeah.
I don't know what
there's actually a brown widow that's. Look up your pest in your areas. Make sure you don't have brown widows because they have like white spots on the bottom and they look like a black widow.
Yeah, that's what I got. But
brown.
As long as they stay in there.
Yeah, they don't eat much.
Yeah. No, we have a horrible problem is wolf spiders. Horrible wolf spiders here. And I was working on an old redwood house, and when we pulled the trim off the windows, there was like tarantula-sized wolf spiders underneath. It was,
yeah, they get huge, huh?
It was scary. Yeah. It was,
yeah.
It's like a, you know, Journey to the Center of the Earth crap right there.
Yeah, no, we get them up here, too. And then we actually have a tarantula that lives up here. It's a small tarantula. I've never seen them in the houses, but... when I go to, like, if I'm doing sprinkler work or something, I go to shut off a water meter, I see them in there all the time.
Yeah.
Black widows, tarantulas, wolf spiders, and, yeah, all kinds of weird critters. And meat bees. You get meat bees down there?
What's a meat bee?
They're a ground hornet.
I think so.
And they hang around like barbecues and stuff. We get them real bad up here.
Yeah.
And they bite you. They hold on with their mandibles, and then they sting you. And
yeah.
Oh my God, it feels like someone putting a cigarette out on you and just holds it there. I got bit by one. I don't know, last week or something. I get a hit a couple times a year by wasps, bees, whatever. But,
I know what that feels like. That guy Josh put a cigarette out on my arm when we were at the Reading show.
Yeah.
You're a liar.
Hey, Josh. You're a liar. That was a cigar. It's cool. It's my blunt.
Jeez.
So how'd the show go today, Josh? Good?
Oh, man, it was crazy. It was start to finish packed.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we moved 50, 60 geckos out, so that was real nice and a much-needed relief.
Yeah.
On the rack space.
That's about how many I need to move out. Maybe 100.
I think I have about that many tubs on top of racks right now, so they'll get filled right back up. But
yeah,
it won't be as bad.
No, it's... No, that's cool.
Yeah, it was great. Joel Ebarbe, he puts on the Portland show and the Renton show, and that's the fourth show we've done that he's put on, and it's just been awesome every time.
Yeah, see, I should have went to that one.
Hey, I tried to tell you guys.
I know.
Next year, man.
You guys better. The next one's in January in Portland.
Oh, I don't know.
January?
Yeah, they have a January and an August show in Portland that Joel puts on.
I don't think
January
I can get out of Eureka time. In January.
Yeah, you get snowed in there, huh? I get.
Oh,
yeah,
it's not bad over in Portland.
Yeah.
Well, maybe where Morgan's at.
Yeah, no, he's got to go over to the Trinity
Mountain.
Yeah.
Yeah, you Trinity should... or yeah, Suicide Pass.
Just put on your
big boy North.
Yeah. Tire chains, man.
Yeah, yeah.
when the roads aren't even open.
So what?
Over the snow.
You can do
less,
it.
Less traffic, man.
That's ridiculous.
So you guys going to make it up next year then?
I might have to.
Yeah. Well,
we should just do, we'll do one of the islands and get like 8 tables.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to do your show, right, at the end of May?
At the end of May. We'll have a show in June. We have one on October 4th in Spokane.
I know that.
Yeah, in Spokane, yeah. That's what I was thinking about doing.
I don't know if I can make this year.
No,
I don't know if I can do October.
Make it up.
Maybe I'll just come hang out.
There you go. I got another buddy coming up from Reno for the show.
Cool.
Corey Van Hoos from CSM Geckos.
Oh, yeah, CSM. He's got some cool variety of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, he'll be coming up for the show. So we had four or five more at the show that said they're going to come, and one of them paid for it.
I didn't touch anything.
Cool.
Mrs. Holly, you're on the air.
You're on the air.
Sasha's on.
She said you're on the air. She can't figure out her phone.
Hey, guys.
Okay. You tied
hey,
into it.
There she is.
Peer pressure. How's
I've been
it going?
Trying to change channels with it. Good. So you had fun at the show also?
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, like Josh said, it was just packed. It was awesome. A lot of good people, a lot of good questions. We just had a blast.
Cool.
Yeah.
What morph of geckos did you sell the most of? Did you get rid of your blizzards? Or?
Actually, yeah. We sold, I think, 7 or 8 blizzards. Sold a lot of giant stuff, too.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I've got quite a bit of, well, possible giant. I call everything possible giant, even if it's from a super giant to giant.
Yeah. Well, then, we almost sold all the panther geckos that we brought, and almost all
the
fat tails as well. Oh, yeah.
You got any females left?
We brought. Female crested's?
Yeah.
Hey, do we have any female crested's left?
No, we actually sold our last one at the end of the show.
Oh, man.
Where's that?
That's the last
Where's
sale
that
you were
button
in.
To hang up on these people?
These people?
Yeah, with chopped liver.
There'll be some at the Chico show. People, I know a couple people that are bringing crested's there.
Yeah, Ron's Reptiles.
Yeah, we'll be...
I'm buying half of his stuff already. I plan on it.
We did pick up some Benoy geckos.
Oh.
Yeah, they're, what is it, parthenogenic or whatever you say it? They're all females.
Yeah,
What's that?
Pinoy?
Yeah, the Benoy. I don't know how you properly say it, but
they're
yeah,
just
I've been
tiny
wanting
and
to get
cute.
Them for a while.
Benoy.
Yeah, they're really tiny.
Yeah.
They're smaller than the panthers.
Oh, man. And they're parthenogenic, so you don't have to, like, do you have any males? No. Do you have any females?
Nope.
Or you just say, yeah, they're all males. They're all females.
How do you spell that, Binoy?
That's B-I-N-O-E-I.
Binoy? Yeah, I was reading something about them.
Something like that.
God, just the other day. Let me see if I can find...
Google them.
Yeah, they're an Australian lizard, but you want to keep them in groups, you know, for laying.
Yeah.
But as far as I understand, groups of three does the best. This is all new to me, so I don't know, but that's the information I'm getting from a couple people. So I traded for two, and then I found out about the three thing, so I bought another one. Oh, yeah, and have you ever guys dealt with confused flower beetles?
I don't know.
Yeah, me neither. This is new to me.
What are they, a feeder, or?
Yeah, they're really tiny. But I bought a colony off them from the lady, Katie Adams, that I got the Binoys from.
Oh, and that's what they eat, or?
Yeah, and I guess they just reproduce like crazy.
Huh. Why are they confused?
That's what I said. I thought she was
calling
me when she told me.
No, yeah, I used to do pest control, but I remember seeing something like that. If, you know, when you're doing the insect ID or the bug ID.
Yeah, well, the geckos are so small, you know, it's... The first thing I asked was, what do they eat? Because they're so tiny. But, yeah, that's what she feeds them, and they do great.
Just exclusively on the confused beetles there, confused flower
beetles.
Well,
while they're babies. Once they, you know, get bigger and they can fit other stuff in their mouth, and you start feeding them dubias and worms and, you know, the normal stuff.
Yeah. No, that sounds interesting.
Yeah, it'll be a new adventure, I guess.
Yeah, and not a whole lot of people have them. I mean, you don't see them all the time, so it's kind of a new thing to work with. I like that.
Yeah, that's what I'm excited about.
Yeah, got the leopard geckos down.
Yeah,
I need
to work down on those.
I need a challenge.
Yeah, then we should be getting some knobtails in like a week or two.
Cool.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
But, yeah, there wasn't much that I was, interested in picking up at the show, you know, for us. But there was nice selection, big variety, tons of vendors. But
yeah.
I didn't have a whole lot of time to walk around and look at everything either.
Yeah, that's cool. that's you want that?
Yeah, it was a good thing, but you
just
know,
a one-day show.
Yeah, it's just a one-day show. All Joel's shows are one day.
Yeah, I think I like the idea of one-day shows.
I actually do too. We've done a couple two-day shows now, and it's, you know, that Sunday, it's just slow. I mean,
yeah,
I'd rather head home and put animals away. But I don't know. We'll see. We're actually thinking about doing a 2-day show next year, but we'll see how it goes when we get this kicked off.
Just yeah, they're nice for, you know, like if a lot of people, well, like the Sacramento show. I know, the past four or five, six years, whatever. I've been going to it. I've been going on Saturdays, and I get there like way early, and get first in line. And it's so crowded that you almost don't enjoy it just because, you know, you got to punch people to look at stuff. Get out of my way.
Well, like, you know, this show, you know, I came about 2:00. I came up to the front to get some change, and there was probably 150 people still in line at about 2:00.
Wow.
Yeah, it was nuts. It was great, though.
Huh. Are you shipping geckos out on Monday? Yvonne asked in the chat room.
Yeah, if her weather's good.
Okay.
I was gonna touch base with her tomorrow night after I get back home. I got to drive 6 hours tomorrow, so.
Yeah, no, she just asked in the chat room, I'm sure.
Yeah, weather permitting, that's the only thing we're on. I got the phase 22 in for her that she requested, so we are good to go on my end.
Yeah.
So, yeah, actually, I think we have a couple packages going out this week, so.
Yeah, I know I've been watching the weather all over the place, and no, my daughter messaged me, but no, the weather's been pretty good here. It hasn't been too bad. It's like 86. It's a high of 80s, you know, high 80s here.
Yeah.
If I put a cool pack in there and don't drop them off till a little before 4, they'd probably be fine.
Yeah.
Depending on where they're going.
Our FedEx, they take them, I think, till like 5:30 or 6, so it's kind of nice that way.
Yeah. I think 4 or 5, I think, is the cutoff time. I go right by the Chico Airport there, so they go directly from there onto the, you know, onto a plane to wherever they're going.
Yeah. I usually wait till, you know, kind of last minute, so it's in FedEx's hand as little as possible.
Yeah. And I know I could do it where they pick them up at my house or, like, one of the places up here, one of the authorized agents, but I, you know, the less time they spend in a truck, you know.
The better your odds.
Yeah, I see the FedEx guys always stopping at some place down there in Chico or at a McDonald's up here, and the truck sitting out there for, you know, an hour or whatever, and it's like, yeah, you're cooking them.
Yeah.
They don't care. They're eating cheeseburgers.
So, hey, are you guys all going to Chico? Oh, go ahead, Morgan.
Yeah, I'm also talking about Chico. I heard back from Bruce. For anybody that's listening that is wanting to go to the show, he's going to try to set up some type of meet and greet for Friday night. And,
oh, yeah.
Cool.
Setup on Friday is going to start at 2 p.m. So he's going to give us a lot of time.
Yeah,
that's nice.
That's what he did. Last year, too, I went down there Friday.
Really?
And everybody was setting up, yeah.
Yeah, and Saturday morning will be at 7 a.m.
Yeah, and it doesn't open.
What time's that show starting? 10?
From 10 to 5, I think.
Yeah, okay. Something like that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's what it is. But,
cool. I'm looking forward to that show. Andy got
me too. Yeah, and he has, I'm not, it's in the, I have the thing right here. I don't see. He's got the commercial building or commerce building or something. I know what building it is.
Yeah, he had the smaller building last year. The one right next to it, which is the bigger one.
Yeah, and my daughter seen him down in Chico today. He was passing out, I don't know, they had a big thing down in Chico, and I guess he had a booth down there, and he was passing out flyers.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, he's on top of it.
That's good.
Yeah.
Get the foot traffic in there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that place is busy all the time anyway, so, I mean, yeah, and I've told a whole bunch of people up here, I think I'm going to hit them up for some flyers and pass them out up here.
Yeah, definitely.
I know a lot of it. I'm sure there's a lot of people from up here on the ridge that go down there, you know, just from the few people that I've talked to up here. But a lot of it is, you know, like Orville and Redding and Calusa, a lot of local stuff.
Yeah, is Chico down there kind of like a bigger place than Redding?
As far as the city?
It is, isn't it?
The people.
I think there's more per capita, probably. Redding's kind of big. I'd have to look at it on a map. Redding's pretty big. There's lots to do in Redding.
Yeah.
But there's also
Chico,
a college in Chico.
Yeah, Chico State, and a lot of people go through Chico. There's a lot of history. A lot of stuff to do. And it's at the Silver Dollar Fairgrounds.
Yeah.
Which there's always something going on there. There's, you know, every weekend there's a flea market, and they have the slot car races, and I think, that's Chico Heat, baseball or something. I don't know, there's all kinds of stuff going there. That's down in the big city, though.
But you're going to make that one, right, Morgan?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think so. Did you ever find out about
that?
You
going to try another live show?
I might. What?
Go ahead.
I might try to do a Friday night show, or do Saturday night after the show, or do both.
Do the Friday night at the meet and greet, and you can talk to all the vendors.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah. Might not be as noisy.
Noisy. Kids next to me screaming.
Yeah. You're going down. You're gonna try to get there Thursday, huh, Josh?
Yeah, we're gonna try and get in Thursday this time and take off Monday.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
I'm tired of going to these shows and having to rush everything. I'm beat.
Yeah.
We were gonna leave tonight, and I said, forget that. Get another room.
No, it's, you know, why kill yourself over it? You know, it's supposed to be fun.
That was me being cheap, trying to save some money.
Yeah. No, that's always an issue too, but you did get at the show, enjoy it.
that's pretty much it.
That'd be cool. Yeah, Friday, there's all kinds of places to go, you know, real close to there.
So you're saying we'd go out herping?
Yeah, no, I know a couple spots.
I'd love to be able to get out herping while I'm down there. That'd be awesome.
Yeah,
it would herp and go to the river. There's some cool spots right by the, the creek there. Bear Hole, Salmon Hole. Upper Bidwell Park.
Sounds like a Friday of fun to me.
Yeah. No, it's all kinds of exploring. Actually, Bidwell Park is huge. It's bigger than New York Central Park. I think it's one of the biggest in the country. I don't know. I remember reading something about it. It's like, no way, I didn't know that. But it's pretty huge. But all kinds of gopher snakes around lately.
Yeah. All I found was garters last weekend.
You know, yeah, I know a couple spots where you can find garters, the checkered garters, and then, like the three-lined garters. The one I go to all the time, the one swimming spot I go to all the time, they're all over the place. My daughter goes out there and catches them.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, no, it's fun stuff. I go catch them, too.
It is loud here.
Is it?
Yeah, there's so many people outside of the hotel right now.
Tell them to go back inside. You're trying to do a show.
Yeah, I know. I'm moving. I'll walk around the building.
Don't you guys know this is live? It's going to go on the permanent record.
Go into a public place. Can you keep it down? I'm trying to do a show.
Inconsiderate.
Yeah. I own this town.
So is Chico your guys' next show then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
2 weeks, right?
Is
that only two?
3 weeks?
3 weeks?
I don't know, something like that.
That's a lot better.
3 weeks. Oh, yeah, it is 3 weeks. Yeah, because next weekend we've got Ray
20 days.
And then,
Ray Designer Geckos, come on, cool.
Yeah, he's got a super big announcement to make.
Uh-oh.
Sweet.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. And I don't think it's a new morph.
Darn it.
Sorry to disappoint everybody.
No, I was just looking at his page today or yesterday. You know how you gecko surf and look at what everybody's doing and everything? I always look at his because he's working with that Firefox thing.
Yeah,
and I'd like to get some of those bloodlines. Yeah, my tangerines are good, but I mean they. And I got a couple that are still holding their color after a couple years of breeding. But you know how when they hatch, they're really, you know, when they're young, they're really, really bright and shiny. And then, you know, a year goes by or a couple years and they kind of dull out a bit. The color spreads out, especially after breeding. But, I'd like to work with some of those. Just not $500 worth.
Yeah,
I got asked quite a bit today about tangerines, if I had any tangerines.
Ooh. Did you tell them you'll have willows at the Chico show?
No, I did not.
Well, you should have gave him my number. I got tons of tangerines.
I actually pointed one guy to your direction.
Yeah, all right, cool.
Yeah, he's like, what do you got for tangerines? Nothing.
Shoot, I got white and yellow tangerines, tangerine greens.
Yeah,
boiled
I said you had tangerine
shrimp.
Everything. I said, get a hold of this guy. He's got tangerine everything.
No, that's one of my favorite morphs, man. I love the tangerines. I get people that message me all the time. So what do you got? I got tangerines. So it's just a tangerine? Is it head eclipse? Nope, just tangerine. You get that a lot. It's just a tangerine. Yeah. At the end of the day, it's just a tangerine.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, it's just a super snow, or at the end of the day, it's just anything else, but
exactly.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah, snows. I sold a lot of snows today, too.
Did
really?
You?
Those are always popular up here.
Yeah. I hear those are sold, like it shows, those sell a lot, pretty much all of the above board. Those are a good seller.
Yeah. Yeah, we do sell a lot of snows, and that's probably the most popular one in the shop as well.
Yeah.
What do those go for?
You know, it depends. I think the cheap ones I sold today were 50 on up to 100 plus.
Wow.
Yeah, depending on the genetics, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got a bunch of $40 max snows I'll be bringing to a Chico.
There you go. I bet you move a lot of them.
Snows
a lot down there last year.
Yeah, no, I got a bunch of snows too. Mine are fascio crosses that I don't want to sell them for $40, but
no. I'm talking like there is no like bloodline behind them. You know,
snow.
They're all het for Raptor because they were all testers. You know.
Oh, but they're just het for Trimper or something.
Yeah. They're not double het. They're just.
Yeah.
They proved that my male is, or my female is pure, so.
Yeah. That's cool.
Yeah.
No, I've test geckos. Feed them to gargoyles.
Kind of, right?
Get yourself some leeches.
They eat everything.
Who was that was feeding picks out of leeches? Was that what I was seeing?
There's a lot of people that do that, man.
Yeah, because they just breed like rabbits.
Yeah.
Huh.
Those are your, you know, $5 geckos that are, you know, they just throw them in a big tub and let them go crazy.
No, I had a bunch of house geckos. I don't know. Way back when I bought like a 1 in 10 group of those. And I had an aquarium and... I had one full of those, and I had one full of the green anoles, and I still like both of those. They're still cool animals, but I know the house geckos, they bred crazy. I mean, after a season, I had like 3,000 of them or something. Yeah, I didn't even take the eggs out and incubate them or nothing. They just, I look in there one day and there's little tiny geckos cruising around. It's like, whoa. But, and then I find out, oh, they use those to feed, Solomon Island boas or, young corn snakes or... Yeah, young corn snakes that won't eat, my shed will eat them. And, there's a whole bunch of them. I took them to, I sold a bunch of them to a couple pet stores.
I don't think I can do it, though.
Yeah,
I don't think I can feed geckos to them.
Yeah.
Feed geckos to geckos?
Yeah. I like them too much.
I know I sold off a bunch of the house geckos and to pet stores because they were feeders. And it's, okay, here, I'm gone, bye.
Yeah, get in, get out.
Yeah, and it's just part of nature. It's,
that's exactly it.
It's rough.
Life,
It
is what it is.
Like feeder bunnies.
Yeah. Fluffy chop.
I got a bunch of those in the freezer.
Yeah. People eat them, too. I want to get a rabbit hutch. Yeah, that'd be awesome.
No, I know someone that breeds rabbits in Redding.
Yeah.
Yeah,
me too.
She has all kinds of...
So where's everyone else tonight?
I don't know.
They don't want to hang out. Brad said he had nothing to talk about, and Jeremy didn't text
Brad's
me back.
Brad's got something to talk about. Brad?
No. He must have a hot date or something.
Yeah. I don't know where Steven is. Steven, bailed on us completely. I don't know.
He's on Instagram.
Well, he got that girlfriend, and... Then it was he had to go into the bathroom to whisper into the phone to talk to us. And
who are you talking to?
Yeah, right. Why is the door locked?
Jake from State Farm. Wearing khakis. She sounds hideous.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
What is it, that time?
Huh?
What time is it?
Is it what time? Oh, is it that time? I'd like to thank our generous sponsors, Luxurious Leopards, Lulus Leo Lovables, SC Geckos, The Reptile Report Marketplace, Holly's Homebred Reptiles, Happy Gecko Sticky Situation, and Top Notch Leopard Geckos before we go away. And I don't think we'll do an after show tonight. We'll leave it 2 hours, yeah.
Yeah, I'm all yapped out. Yap.
Yeah.
Hey, I won a gecko at an auction today at Luxurious Leopards.
Yeah, what'd you get, a sunrise?
Sunrise, or Sunset Mill. Sunset Blizzard Mill.
Those are pretty colorful.
Yeah, I'm... going to work it into some other stuff I got going.
Yeah.
Hit up Heather from Airway. She's got some of that stuff.
Does she?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
She was talking to me about it the other day in the shop.
Yeah, I just talked to her
last night. Oh, is she where you're at?
What's that?
Who?
She's up
Josh
there with
is.
You?
Yeah, she lives 20 minutes from me.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. You should tell her to come on the show or... fill out the application to come on or something.
If I can get her on.
I'll
ask her she's going to be vending the show in October there in Spokane. It'll be her show.
She told me that you said that I was coming up there.
Yeah.
No, I'm considering it, really.
Up.
Yeah, I'm considering it. It would be a nice break to get away from here around October.
It's always nice to, get out of your hometown for a weekend.
Yeah.
We're all still doing SAC at the end of September, right?
Yes, sir.
Hanging out, not vending.
I won't be there.
Oh.
You're not even going to come hang out? Come in, hang out with the guys?
As much as I'd love to.
You don't want to drive 20 hours?
I gotta slow down. Yeah.
20 hours, good.
I think that one's a 15 or 16-hour drive.
Really? Oh, geez.
Yeah. It's a little far.
Yeah. All right. Well, I guess we'll close the show, and everybody don't forget Ray from Designer Geckos is coming on next week to talk about his book and some other really special announcements. So, Jeff and Josh, it was great talking to you guys.
Yeah.
Thanks,
well,
guys.
It was good talking to you, too.
Yeah,
we'll,
I think this
we'll
is the first show
soon,
where...
Josh.
Yeah. All right. See you guys later.
All right. Good night, guys.
All right. Good night, man.
All right. Bye.
Right.